Good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the 17th edition of the Study Circle meeting today. Today we have a senior advocate, Mr. M. Ajmal Khan, to address us in Article 30, Subclass 1 of Constitution of India. I now call upon Mr. Sundar Mohan to give an introduction about him.
Good afternoon, Mr. Ajmal and friends. I have a great pleasure in introducing Mr. Ajmal Khan, a senior advocate who's sought after, most sought after in the Madurai bench of the Madras High Court. He doesn't actually require any formal introduction, but some facts you may have to know. Mr. Ajmal Khan was born in the year 1965 in Ramanathapuram district, was enrolled in the year 1988, completed his ML from the Madras Law College in 1991, was initially attached to the office of Mr. G. Masilamani, senior advocate, and then later joined the office of Mr. K.S. Ahmed, who was then the public prosecutor for Pondicherry. Started independent practice in the year 1994 and shifted to Madurai after the formation of the Madurai bench in 2004. Was designated as a senior advocate on 10-5-2012. And he has been the standing counsel for many institutions like Manon Manim, Sundaranar University, Tuat Board, Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Tamil Nadu Work Board. He is going to talk on Article 31 of the Constitution. On a personal note, I may add, though I practice on the criminal side, this is a topic which is very dear to me, because after enrollment, I joined Mr. Habibullah Basha. I was attached to Mr. Ilyas Ali. The very first case I was asked to draft was on a dispute in a minority institution where a grant was refused. So this topic is very dear to me and very interesting. Mr. Ajmal Khan, over to you. Please go ahead.
Good evening to everybody. At the outset, I'm grateful to my friend, Mr. Om Prakash, the learned senior advocate, Mr. Sivasanmugam, and my friends who are behind the study circle for having given me this opportunity to sit before you and to share my thought on Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. Is it a right or privilege? So general perception that is available among the people. So the minorities are enjoying special privileges in the Constitution of India, which the majority do not. Let me put a question to myself. Is it really the minorities are enjoying special privileges in the Indian Constitution, which the majority do not? Let us examine in this topic. Article 30, Clause 1, is it a right or privilege to minorities? Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India, which needs no introduction to my learned brothers at the bar, which states all minorities, whether based on religion or language, shall have right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. This is what Article 30, Clause 1 states. We'll have to examine, we'll have to understand the provision that is enshrined in this Constitution, that is also incorporated in Part 3 of the Constitution of India, which we all know it is a fundamental right. The background on which the provision was incorporated in the Indian Constitution, especially in Part 3 of the Constitution of India. I would like to tell you what Lord Acton said. Lord Acton, he said, a certain test to judge a state, a country, whether it is really a free country, the amount of rights enjoyed by the minorities. If one sees the amount of right enjoyed by the minorities in a country, and we can say that it is a free country. That is what Lord Acton said. Similarly, Franklin Roosevelt, and he said, referring to minorities, no democracy can survive if a country do not accept the or recognize the right of minorities. So if a country, whether it is a civilized, it is a free country, it's a democratic country which gives right to all the people, can be judged. from the fact that the amount of right the minorities are enjoying, the recognition of rights of minorities by the concerned state, and coming to the historical background, if we see prior to the drafting of constitution, we have got Canadian constitution which recognized the right of minor minorities, ethnic minorities in the constitution itself. And we have got the benefit of working of all constitution which you all know, that apart we have experienced prior to the drafting of the constitution of India, partition of our country, followed by communal riots, and the sense of insecurity that was created in the mind of the minorities by virtue of the communal riots that broke out on the eve of partition. And we also experienced Second World War, how the minority Jews were treated by majority Nazis in Germany, and they have been harassed, killed. So the working of all these constitution and the circumstances in which the our country was partitioned and followed by communal riots, that made our founding fathers of the constitution to think over conferment of certain rights to the minorities in order to give a sense of security in the mind of the minorities that they are safe in India. It is only in this context Constituent Assembly has incorporated Article 25, Article 26, Article 29, and Article 30 of the Constitution of India, and that was also incorporated in Part 3 of the Constitution, holding that these rights conferred on the minorities are fundamental right. It's fundamental in its governance. One thing which I would like to share, when the constitution was drafted by the assembly, constituent assembly, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel is the chairman of advisory committee on minorities. He spoke in the constituent assembly, I want to share, this committee forms one of the most vital parts of the constituent assembly and one of the most difficult tasks that has to be done by us is the work of this committee. Often you must have heard in various debates in British Parliament that have been held on this question recently. And before, when it has been claimed on behalf of the British government that they have a special responsibility, a special obligation for protection of interest of the minorities, they claim to have more special interest than we have. It is for us to prove that it is a bogus claim, a false claim, and nobody can be more interested than us. Nobody can be more interested than us in India in the protection of our minorities. Our mission is to satisfy every interest and safeguard the interest of all minorities to their satisfaction. So according to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, the chairman of advisory committee on minorities, and he claimed that the mission for the founding father of the Indian constitution is to satisfy everybody and to satisfy the minorities to their satisfaction, not to the satisfaction of the founding fathers, but to the satisfaction of the minorities. So in this background, Article 30 clause 1 is incorporated. Even there was a debate in the constituent assembly even for naming the minorities. Even T.T. Krishnamachari, one of the member in the constituent assembly, has also suggested for substitution of the word minorities with certain classes, but that was rejected. Minorities, the word minority is incorporated in Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. It has to be seen this background and historical background for the framing of Article 30, Clause 1 of the 30, Clause 1 in the Indian Constitution has to be seen in the light of unique feature that we have in India, unlike other country where they have one race, one tribe, one language, one culture, and we have a different languages, culture, tribes, religion, caste. That is the reason why we are proud to say that unity in diversity. And I want to tell you what is considered and incorporated in paragraph 158 of TMA Pai Foundation case. While referring to India's cultural identity, the Supreme Court has said we have got 6 ethnic tribes, 52 major tribes, 6 major religions, 6,400 caste and subcaste, 18 major languages, and 1,016 minor languages. That is India. That is our cultural identity. And therefore, unless we make certain provisions to protect the interest of certain groups, there will be a sense of insecurity in the mind of the people. That is the reason why there is a historical background on which the provision under Article 30, Clause 1 was incorporated. To finish with this historical background, just I wanted to share my personal experience with you. Immediately after completing law in 1988, I attended an interview in Bhopal in 1989. That was for the post of second lieutenant in Indian Army in Judge and Advocate General Department, where the law is the qualification. I attended that interview. I went to Bhopal by train. I got down and in the early morning, and I have just went to a mosque which situates just opposite to railway station. I prayed my morning prayer and I have encountered with them, the people who are there in the mosque, the whereabout of army headquarters in Bhopal. I asked them in English. They replied something in Urdu. I didn't understand Urdu. Then I asked them in English. They said in Hindi also. I didn't know Hindi. I told them, I know English and Tamil. You please talk to me in English. Immediately, he kept to say, Musliman. He was questioning me as if, am I a Muslim? Because I don't know. I didn't know Urdu. I didn't know Hindi. I am asking him to speak in English. You just see a person belonging to a particular community, hailing from south, goes to north, and speaks to a person belonging to the same community, language varies, culture varies. So immediately I was reminded of Bipin Chandra's Modern India, where Bipin Chandra has said, a Muslim and a Hindu in south have more common features, common culture, common food habits than a Muslim in North India and a Muslim in South India. Immediately, I was reminded of that quotation from Bipin Chandra, historian, which I have studied in Modern India. That is India, because we have got so much of cultures. So, cultural pluralism, so pluralistic society is ours. And therefore, we love to safeguard the interest of, not to satisfy, to safeguard the interest of each and every one in India. That is the background on which the provision under Article 30, Clause 1 is incorporated, along with Article 25, 26, 29, 30 in the Constitution of India, making it a fundamental right. Yes. Now, let us come to the definition of minority. Who is minority? Article 30, Clause 1 says, all persons, all minorities, whether based on religion or language, shall have right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. Then who is minority? Is there any definition in the Constitution of India as to minority? No. The word minority was considered by the Supreme Court for the first time in INRI Kerala Education Bill. In INRI Kerala Education Bill, that was reported in 1959, 1 SCR 995. The contention of the state government was, what has to be considered to define the minority is the region where the educational institution is situated. The people who are numerically less than the total population of the concerned region, then they are minorities in that region. For instance, I can say in Kerala, in Malappuram district, Muslims constitute majority. If a educational institution is situates in Malappuram, then according to state government, state of Kerala, Muslims are not entitled to claim minority status, because in that region of Malappuram, Muslims constitute majority, and therefore they can't be considered as minority. That was the contention of state of Kerala, but that was rejected by Supreme Court in 1959. However, the Supreme Court has not gone into the fact whether it is a state wise or region wise or the country as a whole as a unit for considering treating the minority as treating the people as a minority. That was not considered by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has only rejected the consideration of the minorities on the region wise and held that you should consider the population of the people on the state wise without going into whether it is a country wise or state wise or region wise. That was the first case that considered the term minority. And thereafter, there are arguments on either side whether the minority can be, whether the state is the unit or the country as a whole as a unit for determining the word minority. Ultimately, it was settled down by Supreme Court in 11 judges bench case in TMA Pai Foundation, that is reported in 2002, 8 SEC, page 481. In TMA Pai Foundation case, it was 11 questions were placed before the bench to give an authoritative pronouncement. The Supreme Court has decided as many as 7 questions and they left to the regular bench to decide the rest of the questions. The first and foremost question that was placed before the Supreme Court was in 11 judges bench was, what is the unit for deciding the minority? That is a definition for minority. That was the first question. The Supreme Court has ultimately held for deciding the minorities, the state shall be the unit. And the Supreme Court went on to hold that the people, whether based on religion or language, that is religious minorities or linguistic minorities, whose population constitute less than 50% of total population of the concerned state, shall be the minorities in that state. That is what the Supreme Court has said. The religious minorities or the linguistic minorities whose population is less than 50% of the total population in the concerned state shall be minority in that state. So, applying the judgment of TMA Pai Foundation case, you see, mostly Christians, Muslims are considered as minority in most of the states. And Hindus are considered as majority and do not have the benefit of Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. However, in northeastern states, namely Mizoram, Meghalaya, and other few states, except three states in northeastern states and Punjab, Hindus constitute minority. Hindus are treated as minorities because the population of the Hindus in those northeastern states and Punjab are less than 50% of the total population of the concerned state. And therefore, the Hindus are treated as minority. They are entitled to avail the protection under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. And similarly, linguistic minorities. If you see, take Tamil Nadu. In Tamil, Tamil is the mother tongue for the majority of the people who live here. The people who speak Urdu, the people who speak Telugu, Malayalam, Kannada, who reside in Tamil Nadu and who start an institution in Tamil Nadu, they are entitled to claim minority status under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India on the ground that they are linguistic minorities because their population, the people who speak those languages, constitute less than 50% of the total population of Tamil Nadu. And therefore, they have got the benefit of protection under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. This is with regard to religious minority and linguistic minority. And certain denomination, for instance, Arya Samaj, Brahma Samaj, Ramakrishna Mission, and they also claim by virtue of their religious denomination, they should also be considered as minorities. But the Supreme Court has rejected in Siddheshwar Sai case, the Supreme Court has rejected that they are only denomination in the Hindu religion and therefore they are not entitled to any protection under Article 30, Clause 1 and they can't be considered as a minority. And even the Supreme Court has gone to hold Jains or reformist movement in the Hindu religion itself. And therefore, Hindus are not, Jains are not entitled to be treated as a minorities. According to Supreme Court, they can be known as Hindus. This is with regard to the definition of minority and the linguistic minorities. Then let us come to Article 30, Clause 1 in detail. As I said, Article 30, Clause 1 states minorities, whether based on religion or language, shall have right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. There is a twin requirement. If you see, all minorities, whether based on religion or language, shall have the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice. There are twin requirements to satisfy Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. The requirement number one is, it should have been established by the persons belong to minority. Number one. Number two, it should have been administered by the persons belong to the minority community. Both requirements should be there to satisfy the requirement of Article 30, Clause 1. Suppose if it is established by a person belong to the minority and it is now administered by a person who do not belong to the minority, then they are not entitled to claim. It loses the character of minority institution when someone who does not belong to that community, whether on religious or language basis, inducted into the board, then the institution will lose its character. The institution will lose its character as a minority institution. In so far as establishment of minority institution is concerned, even a single person is entitled to establish the institution. Not necessary that a collective people belong to a particular community can establish a minority institution. Even a single individual can establish a minority institution. That was held by Supreme Court in State of Kerala versus Mother Provincial. That is reported in AER 1970, Supreme Court page 2079. And so far as the establishment, if you see, just I want to share with you, you may know Aligarh Muslim University. Aligarh Muslim University, it was originally founded by Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. when he founded the institution, it was Anglo-Mohammedan Oriental College, and before independence. Then after independence, Parliament has passed an act, that is Aligarh Muslim University Act 1951, establishing Aligarh Muslim University. Then governing body was formed. Then the question arose, a claim was made that it is a minority institution because it was originally founded by Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, and in the governing body also most of the members constitute minority. The Supreme Court has said it was established by an act, by a statute of parliament, and it is not established by a person's belong to the minority. Though originally Anglo-Mohammedan Oriental College was founded by Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, a person belong to the religious minority, the college was university was established by an act of parliament, and therefore university is not entitled to claim minority status. Even now it is a non-minority institution. The university is treated as a non-minority institution. Likewise, Jamia Millia Islamia, which situates in Delhi, that is also created and established by a statute of parliament, and therefore it cannot be considered as a minority institution. It is still a non-minority institution, and therefore the establishment should be by a person or persons belong to a particular religious or linguistic community to claim the minority status under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. Mere establishment by itself is not sufficient. As I said, it should be accompanied by administration of the said institution by the persons belong to the minority community. Administration, in so far as the administration of the institution is concerned, PMAPOI has dealt with the administration of the minority institution in detail. According to there are so many cases, I just to take you to TMAPOI Foundation, that is reported in 2002 8ACC page 481. There are certain features to say that it is administered by a persons belong to the minority community. There are certain rights that is available to the minority institutions. Those rights are: number one, admission of students; number two, right to appoint staffs, whether teaching or non-teaching staffs; number three, right to initiate disciplinary proceedings against their own staffs; number four, right to form governing board; number five, right to frame fee structure. These are all certain rights that is available to the minority institution. Is it audible?
Yes sir.
Sorry, is it start raining here in Madurai? Once rain comes, our tangent co TNAB people will come alive and they will disconnect all electricity power. Sorry. Yes sir. So certain rights available to the minority institution, as I said, the right of admission of students. They have right to admit students of their choice. That was considered by Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court in St. Stephen's case, that is reported in, I will give you the citation later, where the Supreme Court has said it is a right available to the minority institution to admit students of their choice. However, it is subject to Article 29, Clause 2. If you see Article 29, Clause 2, no person shall be denied admission to any educational institution on the ground of religion. And therefore, that is reported in 1992, 1ACC, page 558. So, Article 29, Clause 2, which is also a facet of fundamental right, which speaks of prohibition of any institution from denying admission to any student on the ground of religion. And therefore, the Supreme Court in St. Stephen's College case has said they shall not, though it is the right available to the minority institution, there should be a balance that has to be struck between the right available to the minority and the right available to the other people under Article 29, Clause 2. And therefore, it should be 50-50. So, minority institution can admit students in the ratio of 50 and leave the remaining 50 for admission of other students. That is what the Supreme Court has said in St. Stephen's College case. However, that was doubted by the Supreme Court in subsequent cases, and therefore it was referred to larger bench. Ultimately, in TME Poi Foundation case, the Supreme Court, while upholding the right of minority with regard to the admission of the students, the Supreme Court has said, in so far as admission of students up to the undergraduate level, it is the inherent right available to the minority institution to admit that students, the students of their choice, up to undergraduate level. And thereafter, in the higher education, the admission should be based purely on merit. And there should be a transparent procedure should be adopted in the matter of admission of students in the higher education level. Whether it is aided or unaided, that makes no difference. According to TME Poi Foundation case, insofar as admission of students is concerned. Then number two, right of appointment. Minority institution has an inherent right of appointment of teaching or non-teaching staffs, and there will be no interference from the state insofar as appointment of teaching or non-teaching staffs are concerned. Only limitation is the institution is bound to appoint only the qualified candidates. Qualification can be prescribed by the state under the Act, Statute, Rule, or anything otherwise. It should be obeyed by the minority institution. At the same time, in the matter of appointment of a qualified candidate, the interference of the state shall be nil. And therefore, even if you see in Islamic Academy case, which was formed to explain judgment of Supreme Court in TME Poi Foundation case, they said reservation should be there in the minority institution. And later, 7 judges bench was constituted in Inamdar case to interpret the judgment of TME Poi Foundation case, which overruled took a different view than that of Islamic Academy case, and has held reservation cannot be applied in minority institution. It is an inroad into the right available to the minorities under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. And therefore, the right to appointment is an inherent right that is available to the minorities. Only thing is, qualification should be prescribed by the state, and they should appoint a qualified candidate. But there is a trend, the recent trend which I would share with you. Even the judgment of TME Poi Foundation case that was followed throughout, even Justice Ravindran in Secretary Malangara Syrian Catholic case, that is reported in 2007. It is of 2007, 2007, 1 ACC, page 386. It's a very good judgment by Justice Ravindran. And he has culled out what are all the rights available to the minorities. He has considered TME Poi case, and he has said right of appointment is inherent. That was the case where appointment of principal, there is a provision in section 57 of Kerala University Act, which provides appointment of principal only on the basis of seniority. And therefore, the governing body has not been given any power to choose their own head, choose their own academic head, namely principal. Kerala High Court has upheld that provision, against which appeal was filed before the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court in Secretary Malangara Syrian Catholic case has held that it is upfront to Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. The governing board has got right to choose their own principal, to choose their own academy head, so that their ideology of the founding fathers of the institution and the ideological or the best person who suits to head the institution can be chosen by the governing board, and therefore the right of appointment of the principal. The only thing is the court has, the state has to see is whether the person who was appointed to the post of principal or any teaching staff is a qualified person or not. That is the only criteria, and therefore it struck down Section 57 of Kerala University Act, holding that the right to appointment of staffs is inherent of Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. Yes. Then now, recently, a trend has changed. A judgment of Justice Arun Mishra. Recently, that has not been reported yet. Only 2 months back, the judgment was rendered. That was in March. That was in March. In S.K. Muhammad Rafiq versus Management Committee Rahmania High Madrasa, where the Supreme Court has upheld Section 10 of West Bengal Madrasa Service Commission Act 2008. Section 10 says teaching faculty can be appointed only on the recommendation made by Service Commission. So they have no independent right. Minority institution has no independent right to appoint any candidate of their choice. They should appoint only the candidate who was recommended by the Service Commission. That was put on challenge. The Supreme Court proceeded over by Justice Arun Mishra in the bench hearing with Justice Lalit. They have now upheld Section 10 of West Bengal Madrasa Service Commission Act 2008. Though the judgment rendered by TMA Pai Foundation case was also incorporated, Malangara was also incorporated, the court has come to the conclusion that such regulation is intra vires of the Constitution of India, that is not violative of Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. Immediately a mention was made before the Chief Justice of India, Justice Bobde. The Chief Justice has referred the matter to larger bench. Now the matter is now before the larger bench, but the larger bench is not constituted as of now. That is the present trend. Then number third, right to initiate disciplinary proceedings. Right to initiate disciplinary proceeding is a facet of Article 30, Clause 1. Right to initiate disciplinary proceeding against their own staffs. Only thing is, according to Supreme Court, the principles of natural justice has to be followed. If the minority institution follows the principles of natural justice, that is sufficient to hold that the action taken by the minority institution in initiation of disciplinary proceeding is correct, well within the ambit of law. Then governing board, formation of governing board. The governing board, insofar as formation of governing body is, the right available to the minority institution is absolute. It should not, it is not circumscribed by any statutory prohibition. They can choose their own governing board, and there cannot be any interference by the state insofar as formation of the governing board. There are certain cases, certain instances in which interference by the state was made by statute, but that was struck down by the Supreme Court as unconstitutional, and that is violative of Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. In state of Kerala versus Mother Provincials, that is reported in 1972 SEC, page 417, the Supreme Court has held the provision providing for the composition of the governing body and also for nomination of government and university representatives is ultra vires. Provision has been made nominating the university representative in the governing body. Some third party is inducted into the governing body, now which loses the character of minority institution, and therefore the Supreme Court in that case has struck down that provision. Similarly, in All Saints High School versus Government of AP, that is reported in AR 1980, that is a 1982 ACC, page 478, the Supreme Court has held the induction of outside authority, either directly or through the nominee into the governing body, is illegal, according to Supreme Court. And therefore, the formation of governing body is absolute, and it should not be circumscribed by any statutory provision, and no interference could be made in the matter of formation of governing body. Then, in St. Xavier's College, Ahmedabad also, that is reported in 1974, 1 ACC, page 717. And yes, the Supreme Court has held interference by the state in the formation of governing body cannot be made. Yes, this is with regard to administration of the institution and the rights available to the minorities in the matter of administration of the institution. Then, whether the right available to the minorities is absolute or it is subject to some restriction, reasonable restrictions. If we take some provisions in the part 3 of the Constitution of India, namely Article 15, there shall not be any discrimination in the matter of there shall not be discrimination on the ground of religion, caste, creed, similarly, Article 16, there shall not be any discrimination in the matter of public employment on the ground of religion, caste, creed. That is what 15.1 may say, but there are exceptions to 15.1, incorporated under Class 4, Class 5, where some special provisions have been made for the advancement of socially and educationally backward classes under Class 4 and Class 5. Similarly, in Article 16, Class 4, Class 5 and Class 6, certain special provisions have been made for the advancement of socially educationally backward classes. And Class 5, backward classes. So there are certain exceptions. The right available under 15 or 16 is not absolute. Similarly, if you take Article 25 is subject to public order, morality or health. Even the very commencement of right conferred under Article 25 reads subject to public order, morality, health. Right to freedom of religion is available. Then Article 26 is also subject to public order, morality or health to start religious institutions, that is religious denomination. So these articles inserted in part 3 of the Constitution are all subject to public order, morality or health. If you take Article 19, right to freedom of speech, assembly, Article 19.1, that is subject to reasonable restriction under Article 19, Class 2. Then Article 19.1G, the founding fathers of our Constitution, founding fathers of our Constitution have thought fit not to make any reasonable restriction and make Article 30, Class 1 an absolute. However, the Supreme Court has made certain restriction, holding that Article 30, Class 1, though it is absolute, but it is subject to certain regulation. Some regulatory measures can be made to enjoy the right conferred under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. The regulatory measures, according to Supreme Court, is it is not in the interest of the public, but it is in the interest of concerned minority institution. And also, that regulatory measures is for some public safety, national security, and some taxation laws can be taxation laws and the town planning laws can be applied to the minority institution. So the right available to the minority institution, though it is absolute under the Constitution of India, was made some regulatory measures by the Supreme Court of India in the interest of the concerned institution and for some public safety and national security and the interest of nation. Then, coming to the rights enjoyed by the minority institution vis-a-vis non-minority institution. To begin with, I have said here, minority institution is enjoying a privilege which the majority do not. Here, that was the general perception that was available among the people. Now, after the judgment of TMA Pai Foundation case, where the 11 judges bench has said the right to establish and administer educational institutions of their choice is not only available to the minorities under Article 30, Clause 1, but it is also available to the non-minorities under Article 19. ஹலோ கேக்குதா? கேக்கல
சார். கேக்குது சார்.
இப்பதான் கேக்குது எனக்கு. சாரி. ரைட். சோ அகார்டிங் டு சுப்ரீம் கோர்ட், நான் மைனாரிட்டிஸ் ஆர் ஆல்சோ என்டைட்டில் டு எஸ்டாப்ளிஷ்மெண்ட் அட்மினிஸ்ட்ரேட் எஜுகேஷன் இன்ஸ்டிடியூஷன் ஆஃப் தர் சாய்ஸ் அண்டர் ஆர்டிகல் 19(1)(g). பட் ஆர்டிகல் 19(1)(g) இஸ் சப்ஜெக்ட் டு ரீசனபிள் ரெஸ்ட்ரிக்ஷன் அண்டர் ஆர்டிகல் 19(6) in the interest of general public. Restriction can be imposed. The only difference between minority and non-minority institution after TMA Pai case is it is subject to one of a minority institution is subject to regulatory measures by law enacted by the legislature, whereas in case of non-minority institution it is subject to reasonable restriction in the interest of general public under Article 19(6) and certain interference by the state will be minimum in case of minority institution in the matter of admission, right of appointment, right of initiation of disciplinary proceedings and the formation of governing body and the fee structure. The interference by the state will be minimum and the interference will be there in the non-minority institution. That is the especially in the aided institution. In so far as unaided institution, the interference will be minimum in even in non-minority institution. That is the difference between minority and non-minority institutions after TMA Pai case. And further, this right conferred under Article 30, Clause 1 is a basic structure of the Constitution of India. It is incorporated in Part 3 of the Constitution of India. Whatever the fundamental rights that is incorporated in Part 3 cannot form basis for the basic structure of the Constitution of India. As you all know, 13 judges bench in Kesavananda Bharathi case has considered what is basic structure. And Justice Sikri, speaking for the majority, he has said, if the power is given to the Parliament to amend all provisions of the Constitution of India, certain powers are conferred on the minorities to establish and administer educational institutions, then the Parliament will go on amending that provision also. Then the will and the guarantee made to the minorities will be lost. And therefore, such power cannot be conferred on the Parliament, according to Justice Sikri. And therefore, what Justice Sikri has meant that Article 30, Clause 1 is the basic structure. Suppose if such power is conferred on the Parliament, the legislature will take away such power that will lose its identity, according to Justice Sikri. Similarly, Justice Hegde and Mukherjee also speaking for the bench in the very same Kesavananda Bharathi case has held, two-thirds of the MPs who are present in the parliament cannot decide for the interest of all the people. Especially, the rights have been conferred on the minorities under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. So, taking the view that the right conferred on the minorities are inalienable and basic structure of the Constitution of India, then in TMA Pai Foundation case, Justice Ruma Pal, in her separate judgment, while referring to Kesavananda Bharathi case, has held the right available to the minorities under Article 30, Clause 1 is inalienable and unamendable. And therefore, it is a basic structure, according to Justice Ruma Pal in TMA Pai Foundation case. And therefore, the right conferred on the minorities under Article 30, Clause 1 is a basic structure of the Constitution of India. Then, I will have to share the position of the minority institutions in Tamil Nadu with reference to Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India. In Tamil Nadu, you know, we have got Tamil Nadu Private Schools Regulation Act, Tamil Nadu Private Colleges Regulation Act, where certain provisions are made. Certain provisions of Tamil Nadu Private Colleges Regulation Act were subject to challenge before Madras High Court. Justice Veerachami, as early as in 1974, he has struck down certain provisions of the Constitution of India, certain provisions of Private Schools Regulation Act. That is, the matter relates to formation of the governing body, appointment of secretary, and appointment of teaching staffs, then initiation of disciplinary proceedings and imposition of punishment under Section 22. There are certain similar provisions that have been struck down by Justice Veerachami. An appeal was filed by the state before the Supreme Court that was kept pending. Ultimately, after the Supreme Court has rendered its judgment in TMA Pai Foundation case, the judgment of Justice Veerachami, the appeal filed against Justice Veerachami was disposed of, remitting the matter to the Madras High Court to decide afresh in the light of judgment rendered by the Supreme Court in TMA Pai Foundation case. That was remitted, and thereafter matter was taken up by Justice L.E.P. Dharmarao bench. And a representation was made by the then Advocate General of Tamil Nadu to the effect that state government is on its legs for the enactment of a comprehensive legislation for minorities also. So that was recorded by the bench. Matter was disposed of. Status quo has prevailed on the judgment of status quo has prevailed on the, hello? Status quo has prevailed on the judgment of Justice Veerachami was directed to be maintained. And thereafter, there is a comprehensive act was enacted by Tamil Nadu is concerned with reference to minority institution. Then, with regard to the privilege, then I want to share some insights into the minority institution where Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act that was enacted in furtherance of powers conferred under Article 21K, Capital A of the Constitution of India. There was an amendment made to the Constitution under 93rd Amendment, incorporating Section Article Clause 5 to Article 15, making some reservation after Inamdar case, making some reservation for the socially and educationally backward classes in the unaided institutions, except minority institutions. That was challenged by non-minority institutions, along with Article 21 Capital A and virus of Right of Children to Free and Compulsory Education Act was also impugned because there is a provision under RTI Act, that is Article Section 12C, which contemplates admission of 25% of the students from the neighborhood in all institutions that was challenged in the Supreme Court. In the Society for Unaided Schools of State of Rajasthan, 3-1 has held Act is intravirous of the Constitution of India, Act is valid. However, the Act will not apply to unaided minority institution. And thereafter, Article 15, Clause 5, 21, Capital A, and the Right to Education Act was challenged by non-minority institutions. And one of the writ petition was filed by a minority institution. Incidentally, I appeared in that case in the Supreme Court. That is the only writ petition, and other writ petitions are filed by non-minority institution that was placed before the larger bench, doubting the correctness of Society for Unaided Schools of State of Rajasthan. Matter was placed before the Constitution bench. Bench has ultimately held Article 15 Clause 5, Article 21 Capital A, then the Right to Education Act is valid. That is intravirous. In so far as non-minority that is rendered in Pramathi Educational Trust and Pramathi Educational and Charitable Trust that is reported in 2014, 8ACC, page 1. The Supreme Court has held. In that case, that it is relevant in so far as prescribing of qualifications are also concerned. In that case, there is a provision under section 23, which contemplates constitution of an academic authority by the central government to prescribe qualification for the appointment of teaching and non-teaching staffs. By virtue of that power conferred under section 23, NCTE, National Council for Teacher Education, was notified by the central government as academic authority to prescribe qualification for appointment. Even in the Supreme Court, when the matter was taken up in the course of argument, I have argued that the 3-judge bench in Society for Unaided Schools of State of Rajasthan have not considered each and every provisions in the Right to Education Act and has only considered Section 12, right of admission of students in the schools, and held that it is intravirous. And each and every provision has to be gone into. Then again, the Constitution bench of the Supreme Court has not gone into each and every provisions and has only simply held it is ultra-virus of Article 30, Clause 1, and it is valid in so far as non-minority institution is concerned. So, based on notification of NCTE as an academic authority, NCTE has also prescribed certain qualification, which includes teachers TET, teachers eligibility test, TET as one of the conditions for appointment. That came to be considered by the division bench of our High Court. Justice Huluwadi Ramesh J has considered, and he said that it was challenged by minority institution on the ground that this TET, teachers eligibility test, is a qualification prescribed under the Right to Education Act, which was held not applicable to the minority institution. And therefore, state cannot claim that the teachers should have teachers eligibility test qualification for the purpose of appointment. Ultimately, division bench has also, following Pramathi Education and Charitable Trust, has held that source of TET is only Right to Education Act, and therefore and which was held to be not applicable to the minority, and therefore state government cannot prescribe condition of TET as a qualification for the appointment of teaching staffs in the minority schools. That is the position in so far as this condition of appointment is concerned. Suppose this condition of TET is incorporated in the Tamil Nadu Private Schools Regulation Act, then minority institution cannot have any say, because minority institution, though have a right of appointment, they should follow the conditions, qualification prescribed by the government. So the qualification once prescribed by the government under the Tamil Nadu Private Schools Regulation Act, along with other qualification, academic qualification prescribed under the Act itself, then the appointment course of TET as a qualification prescribed only to candidates without TET qualification can be appointed. So to finish with, whether this right conferred on the minorities is a privilege. As I said, the background of incorporation of these provisions in the Indian Constitution, there was a sense of insecurity that prevailed among the minorities. So it is under those circumstances, on account of partisan, a separate electorate was demanded that was rejected by the Constituent Assembly. While rejecting the separate electorate, the Constituent Assembly has framed this, conferred this right on the minorities. Whether this whether conferment of this fundamental right to establish and administer educational institutions to the minority is a privilege. Definitely it is not. If you see, incorporation of Article 25, that is right to of religion, right to freedom of conscience, then Article 26, right to freedom, right to establishment of their own institution, religious institution, religious denomination, then Article 29, that is cultural rights, conservation of culture, script or language of minorities. Then this Article 30, these rights have been conferred only to ensure equality. If we take preamble of the Constitution of India, you know, we the people of India, having solemnly constituted India into a sovereign, socialist, secular, democratic republic, and to secure all its citizens justice, social, economic, political. The justice that is contemplated under preamble, then equality of status and of opportunity. The equality of status and opportunity as enshrined in preamble is of the concept of equality is social equality, egalitarian equality, not the equality in letter, the equality in spirit. That is the reason why we have made reservation for the socially and the educationally advanced, educationally backward sections, incorporating class 4, class 3, class 4, and class 5 to Article 15, Article 16 of the Constitution of India. And therefore, it is only to ensure equality, the egalitarian equality, the provisions have been made as a protective discrimination in favor of the minorities. It is not a privilege, but it is a protective discrimination in favor of the minorities to ensure equality, to ensure egalitarian equality. The Constitution have provided the said right as an affirmative action through a fundamental right to instill confidence and security in the minds of the minorities. This right conferred under Article 30, Class 1, is a basic structure of the Constitution of India. I emphasize that the right conferred under Article 30, Class 1 of the Constitution of India is only a protective discrimination in favor of the minorities to ensure equality is, just I would cite an example, illustration, for religious minorities like Muslims. As a committee was constituted by then Congress government under the chairmanship of Justice Chachar, then Chief Justice of Delhi High Court. He has submitted a report. In his report, he says Muslims in India lacks education. In primary education, they are lagging behind scheduled caste. There is a report. So if you see, this egalitarian equality has not been achieved. Even after so much of years of independence, this egalitarian equality, that is the basic structure of our Constitution in India, that is the concept of our founding fathers of our Constitution, have not been achieved even today, as seen from the report of Justice Rajinder Sachar. So, it is only to give a protective discrimination in favor of the minorities. To ensure equality among all, this provision has been made. And therefore, to conclude, I could only say the right conferred under Article 30, Clause 1 of the Constitution of India is not a privilege. It is only a protective discrimination in favor of the minorities to ensure equality among all. Thank you. If you want to put any questions, you may put questions.
Sir has concluded his session. So participants, if you have any clarification or doubts to be raised, sir, you can come forward. You can raise your hands and Shiv Shanmugam will unmute you. Or you can put your questions in the chat box and Shiv Shanmugam will carry forward same to the sir. In the midst of these challenging times, you are able to get along, sir. Halfway through when there were heavy rains and disconnection, you are worried.
Mostly we don't get rain in Madurai. But so fortunately, when we are joined here, we got rain also with heavy thunder.
Yes.
Sir, that's the one question raised by Mr. Rishikesh.
Yes, I have seen that. I have seen that.
Yes, sir.
That is clarified under Clause 2 of Article 30. Clause 2 of Article 30, if you see, even for the acquisition of land belonging to the minority, the character of the minority institution should not be affected. That the land can be land belonging to the minority constitution can be acquired, but the compensation that can be given to the minority institution should be in such a way that should not affect the character of the minority institution. Meaning thereby, there will be a high compensation for the land acquired for the acquired from the minority institution. If you see clause 2 of article clause 1a of article 30, in making any law providing for the compulsory acquisition of any property of an educational institution established and administered by a minority referred to in clause 1, the state shall ensure that the amount to buy or determine under such law for the acquisition of such property is such as would not restrict or abrogate the right guaranteed under that clause. And therefore, it is possible. Land can be acquired, provided the compensation that can be given to the minority institution in is of such a nature that should not abrogate the right guaranteed under Article 13. A compensation should be given. That's all.
Thanks you, sir.
Then,
I remember having read somewhere that there was a further reference in respect of this Paramati Educational Cultural Trust. Is it so, sir? Is it
Yes, sir. In Paramati case was referred to the larger bench, but that is with reference to Article 27. Article 27 is with reference to the payment of taxes to the religious institution. In that context, the judgment of Paramati, the judgment rendered by the Supreme Court in Paramati case was doubted, and it is now referred to the larger bench. Larger bench is yet to be constituted. That is the position. As on date, it holds good in law.
Thank you, sir. Thanks for the clarification.
Thank you.
Is there any other person who wants to raise any issues, sir? Sir, I take it that there are no further doubts or clarifications. No, I find there is one more point. There is a question. What challenges do the minority education institution faces today?
Yes. Challenge is only judiciary. That's all I can say.
What if we call the judgment March of Lies actually, sir, maybe you are saying what we call as March of Lies actually change of law happens.
Yes. March of law is always welcome. But the change of law, according to the change of government, that is not welcome. That is very unfortunate. Only judiciary is the challenge.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for the wonderful evening session. On behalf of the all participants of the day, I want to just say a few words of thanks to you. You had, in fact, taken up one facet of the Part 3 of Constitution, which normally doesn't get that much importance when you look at other fundamental rights which have been subject matter of so much of litigations or so much of jurisprudence which has evolved. But in this one small facet, you are able to make us more informative as well as educative on the entire spectrum of it, taking us through the width of the 31. 31 as it is, if you find it, only it's only two lines of an article. But within the two lines, so much of issues which have been encompassed, so much of rights which have been created, has been wonderfully brought out in this today's evening session. Thank you very much on behalf of all the participants, sir. In spite of tough times, you are able to carry us through and complete the session. We thank you once again, sir.
Sir, before we part or before I end the session, sir, can you send me the list of the citations, sir? Most of that was shared Mr. Vardhaman.
Yes.
But still,
For
to be shared in my WhatsApp.
Immediately, I have a copy of those judgments. I will.
No. Send citations it to list is enough, sir. That's sufficient, sir.
Yes. Please be sent. I have got a list. I will send you now, right now.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for the day, sir.